Well, today I thought what we could do is I thought I'd break down some of the things that were submitted. I saw two submissions this morning, so I made comments and sort of suggested possible projects that could be based on what was written, and so I thought I'd walk through those things, and then we could do a little question answer, a little brainstorming, and then I could also talk about like some common pitfalls just in general of planning projects, especially group work, and talk a little bit about expanding or shrinking the size of projects, keeping them flexible. So, share this. Okay, so what I did was I took from the answers from the Google form, and I just put it into a little chart in a Google Doc. So this first one, by the way, I didn't ask if I could share these things, but I figured
It's all good.
since they were
It's
all
all good.
public, we could all learn from them, we could all share. And also, don't take anything I'm saying as like the last word on any of this. This is just it was just like an initial reaction, and of course these things could all be developed and whatever. Okay. All right. So, with the thinking about connecting practice across disciplines, so the prompt elicited for the African American Studies class, get the students to think about the expression of emotions of enslaved people. Folks through the prism of Negro spirituals like Wade in the Water, Godown Moses, O Freedom, Swing Low, musical elements, spiritual, religious elements. So there's actually a lot here. So I highlighted the things that kind of jumped out to me was the expression of emotions of enslaved people, which to me talks about empathy. And I think that's a key component of project-based learning is if you can get kids to empathize and anything to get them outside of themselves, I find is helpful. And it's a challenging thing to do, but I think it's something worth aspiring to. And then the cross-curricular parts I highlighted, musical elements and spiritual religious elements. So what I wrote was, hold on, let me see if somebody. Yeah, James. So I said, I think the ideas and connections between disciplines will be fruitful. I see these as being complementary, and I think they'll work well together. My comment would be to connect elements of practice. So I always try to think of it's a very easy thing. We're so used to thinking about our content. It's an easy thing to say, okay, I want to cover, we're covering this topic, this period of time. Maybe I could use art of that time. And that is true. That is something that you absolutely can do. However, if you do that, now you have two things that the kids are unfamiliar with. You have the thing that you're trying to teach, and you have the thing that you're trying to use to help them make connections that they're also unfamiliar with. So the way I try to think of it is, what can I use that they are familiar with where we're sort of emulating the thing that we want them to empathize with? Okay. So let's see, what did I write? I'd narrow expression of emotions to be more specific. The more targeted you can make things, I find the more it gives you sort of a launching point, even though when you do your big idea, the big idea can be, it can be broad or it can be like laser focused. It can be either one, both of them work. So I always try to be really specific when thinking at this level, because you can always pull back. Like if you're looking at something through a microscope, you can always take the bird's eye view at any point. It's easier to pull back. Also, make sure, I mean, this is me speaking as a musician. When you talk about music with words, be really specific if you're going to talk about text or the musical part, because music has meaning as well. My sense is this will be more successful if you save the content and abstract the conditions and dynamics of power of how African American slaves use music to survive. Second part, list your big idea. So the response was, using music to serve as a beacon of hope and freedom, these notions were integrated with ideas around Christianity, baptism, Moses, chariot from heaven. So I really like how it's like sort of brainstormy. I really work that way. I like to just put anything down that I can think of and then go back and just save the parts that I want. So when I read this, I highlighted these notions were integrated with ideas around Christianity. And what that made me think of was, now because I'm a musician, I have some experience with spirituals, and I think of how spirituals are really West African music. I mean, it's African American music. It's a hybrid. But mm-hmm. What was really happening was because in the time African culture was being suppressed to as much as possible to keep people under control, the music was a way for the slaves to maintain their culture, really. And they appropriated aspects of white culture so they could sort of hide in plain sight. And that those things became a code. So it was a way to sort of fly under the radar while being right in front of them. And that's kind of a different story than saying, than taking the ideas of just incorporating religion and maybe seeing the people as just victims. So let's see, what did I comment? Less content focus and more general systemic ideas. Oh, this is the other thing. So if you focus on the content at this point, then you're gonna sort of laser focus your class on those pieces, and you'll get however many kids in your class, you'll get 20, you know, if you got 20 kids, you're gonna get 20 whatevers about Swing Low, Sweet Chariot. That's just what happens, because they don't have enough background knowledge. So I changed the big question to, how can the oppressed use their oppressor's culture as a subversive weapon? Now, that's a pretty targeted big question, but it's just what sort of came to me. But what this does is it saves the content for later, and it really just talks about getting them to understand this power dynamic. And that way you can design your project around empathy and inquiry. And if you can help them connect to this idea, then you can teach them the content, and they'll already feel something about it or understand the dynamic, and it won't be so abstract.
So Stephen, really quick before you move forward, so yes. This is supremely helpful for me. And my question to you would be, obviously you talked about this yesterday about having done this a lot, and even I think you spoke a little bit about like your artistic process helps you think about these a lot. So what I found so powerful, which is why I wrote you the note, right, was that I kind of spent half an hour, that's about all I had last night, into a meeting to think about trying to do this homework. And what I found, and this is what I think is so powerful, is like, I wrote this down and it stirred in you like a brainstorming. So my question is this: as you think about a project, or maybe if you could think back to when you were beginning, like how often did you like write something down, then go back, rethink about it again, like maybe ask these four questions and then kind of remix it, if that may sound like a hokey, but that's what I'm thinking. And I feel like that's what you did. And again, I know I think very linearly and very literally. And then what I saw you do with, you know, my short little pieces of prose was like, you know, really get to the root. Like this question that you put in part two is exactly what I want to do. Mm-hmm. And I wasn't able to say that on my first iteration.
Yeah.
But how did the press use the oppressor's culture as a subversive weapon is exactly how I see spirituals, right? Versus, and again, I think on the surface, they're oftentimes seen as like, you know, again, these five freedoms and hopes, and they're tied to scripture, and they look at some of the parables as the Bible in terms of deliverance to freedom.
Right.
But your question is just so much more like laser focused on what I want to do. And my question just is, I know I'm not being eloquent, it's just how long did it take you to get to that process, and how might we think about, you know, going from what I wrote to that major question you got?
So what I had to practice was, because I did exactly the same thing. I always thought, like, okay, I'm going to teach, if I'm teaching something historically, then I would think, well, let me get something from the same time period. What we often do is say, okay, like I'm teaching this thing in 1850. What is something contemporary with that that will help illuminate that time period? But the problem with doing that is, like I said earlier, now you have two things that they're unfamiliar with. So of the same time period, and it doesn't really help them empathize. It might help a few kids if they happen to know something about that. So it's really about not thinking about the content part and looking for, I think of it like the elevator pitch. Like if I was trying to tell somebody something about this as quickly as possible in like one or two sentences, what would that be? And what would be the essential thing that we could tackle that encapsulates the dynamic in a kind of a contemporary way? That's a very wordy way to say it. But it sounds very strange as a teacher to say, I'm not thinking about the content. But, and it's not entirely true. It's kind of a provocative statement. It's that when I'm doing the planning, I analyze the content for like active verbs. Like basically, where are the places where we can do something? And then what's something that we can do that has that exact dynamic? Like when I go over James' thing next, I'll show you all kinds of contemporary things that you can use. Because what we're trying to teach them is, How can they engage with that dynamic? And then you teach them the content and they understand. It's just a difference of like syntax. So you're teaching them the dynamic and that experience, and then you just change the sort of the conditions. I think of it as like, it makes it so that we're teaching fewer things. And it's more experiential, because if you can abstract the dynamic part and turn that into a mini project to something that they make, then they've had to deal with it. And it's not something that they're just learning intellectually and that they're going to regurgitate. They're thinking about it, and then they have to use it to make something else. And they have to think about that process. So then when they learn about somebody else that did that work and used that process, now they identify. And now it's like, oh, well, how did you solve this problem? So that's why distilling it to kind of an essential question is a really valuable thing. And that part's hard. But the more you do it, the faster you get. And then you start seeing that you draw literally on everything in your life. Like, as we're going to see, you know, the idea I came up with your project was the Kermit meme of sipping tea. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, it's not like if you take it at face value, it's like there's no way your one inspires the other. But it's because I'm looking at it from just a structural point of view. And then I think about something in my own life experience and make a connection with it. And creating a meme is relatively simple and hard at the same time, because thinking of that joke, it's a one-liner. It's like writing a haiku. It's really hard.
Right.
And so they're going to have to think about it a lot. But at the same time, there's some research involved because they can look up examples. So that's what I try to think of to make these things. And let me keep on going. Did that answer?
Yeah, no, thank you. I just
did that answer your question?
Yes, thank you.
So what I kind of honed in with was, really it was about that power dynamic and less so about, I mean, all the things that you said about spirituals are true, and those are examples. But if we just teach that, then it's just another thing that they're going to learn and forget. Where if we can have them do something that's experiential and then show them that these follow that same dynamic, it'll mean a lot more. Mm-hmm. Also, if we ask them, well, let's look at this. So in thinking about the project, students being about to connect theological ideals learned in theology experience, songwriting, lyricism, music, English class to create a piece that ties these ideas to the real experience of 2020. So that's a very ambitious thing. We're connecting cross-curricular ideas with something that's quite difficult, which is songwriting, mm-hmm. creating a piece of music, and then also tying it to something that's contemporary. So Black Lives, the pandemic, quarantine, etc. So these are all possible. And I hope that I actually address those goals. But I think if you ask a kid that has no experience, like writing a piece of music is exceptionally difficult. And it takes a long time and a lot of training. So I don't want a kid to do that. Plus, it's sort of outside the goals of your class. It's outside of that right. curriculum. It doesn't right. mean that those things can't be incorporated. But I think for a project, it's just too hard. It was way too hard. So my comments were, I think the proposed project is a good one, but it's much too difficult and ambitious for untrained students. Remember, the project only has to grapple with the ideas. The ideas can be ambitious, but the execution shouldn't be onerous.
Got it.
So these were things that I sort of distilled from the things that you suggested. Think about what concepts students will demonstrate that let you know they're successful. So this is the evidence we'd look for. Students can empathize with the plight of the oppressed in a contrived scenario, meaning a scenario that you set up the conditions for. So in other words, it doesn't have to have the gravitas of the slave relationship. Students can identify the specific cultural values of the dominant group, meaning that they have some either self-awareness or the ability to analyze who is a dominant group and what that privilege looks like. And then students can use that dominant culture as a tool for a subversion. So they have to be able to identify it. And then they have to be able to, this is the tough part, they have to be able to take something that is part of the dominant culture's privilege and flip it to reclaim power. And there's lots of conversations you can have about that, that can be quite deep. So the project itself, if the idea is to have students to grapple with this social power dynamic, where the minority group reclaims power in the midst of oppression using the oppressor's cultural artifacts, create a project that explores this relationship, not the specific content. So in other words, we don't have to make a spiritual to understand how to flip somebody's privilege and reclaim power, okay? So the project I came up with was to use the Kermit the Frog sipping tea meme. If you don't know it, it looks like this. And there's like a setup on top, and then below it says, but that's none of my business, where Kermit is sort of saying something really passive aggressive. He's pointing out, so basically Kermit is pointing out something that's like something in the everyday that's either inappropriate or, satirical, and then saying, but that's none of my business, and taking a sip of his tea, which is a capture from a Lipton tea commercial. And this was born from like Black Twitter, and it's kind of a brilliant meme. It's very funny often. And what's great about it is it's become so much a part of internet culture that people actually sip tea, and which comes from the Kermit meme. And sipping tea has come to represent almost like when you've just had enough and you need to do some self-care. And so it has like a plurality of meanings. But the Kermit meme is still alive and still has its power. So my suggestion is to talk about the background, give a history on the meme, demonstrate how the meme has made a sipping tea the symbol of self-care or disdain for poor behavior. And then students can research, this could even be just in class, relevant examples to share. The Kermit meme is a gateway into the contemporary topics that you listed, like BLM and the pandemic and things like that. Students can scour Instagram or whatever for relevant examples that speak from the viewpoints of different communities. And there's even things that go back to Sesame Street, like It's Not Easy Being Green, which was a song about racism. And for a while, the Kermit meme had the hashtag like tea drinking lizard. And there was this minor kerfuffle about that Kermit isn't a lizard, and that all things that are green aren't lizards. But they're all metaphors, and it's all funny, and it's all very contemporary. But it's important that it comes from Black culture, I think. I think it's an opportunity to teach about hegemony. You can define and discuss different levels of dominant cultures or subcultures and how those cultures maintain their dominance. And then get kids to talk about what are the dominant cultures that they experience in their lives. This is the key. This is the part of the empathy, because they might not have feelings. We could have very sheltered students who don't have feelings about any of this. Or maybe they do and they've been afraid to talk about it, or they don't know how to talk about it, but they can certainly talk about I don't know, maybe it's like sports culture or video games or being a nerd or whatever it is, there's something that they could talk about where there's a dominant culture in their life. The expansion of this would be to look at, so I tried to think of art things or other resources. One I came up with was a wonderful piece by Kevin Beasley.
There's not going to be a beginning.
So Kevin Beasley had a solo show. He's a young guy. I don't think he's 30. At the Whitney that made a huge splash, where he got an actual cotton gin and made it work, the motor, and put it in a giant glass or plexiglass box so you couldn't hear it anymore, and put all these mics and stuff around it. And then the sound was piped into another room. And it was, what they're not showing in the video is that it was modified with synthesizers and things and became a piece of sound art.
Unpacking that has to happen. Anything other than
this is, I felt like
So
he was driving.
And the property has a
Times,
Virginia, in the summer of 2011. I drove down from New Haven, and the property has a sort of meandering road, right, that leads to the house. And I look up and I see the fields are planted. And I stopped the car and I looked, and I was like, well, what is that? And I rolled the window down, and I saw that it was cotton. And it kind of, it struck me in a way that I couldn't quite wrap my head around. Emotionally, it was too heavy. Mentally, it was too heavy. I felt like I hadn't reconciled something. And I was like, why am I so mad at this plant? You know, like, what, this plant is not doing anything other than like growing and being beautiful. And I felt like, okay, there's a lot of unpacking that has to happen.
You know, I want to actually point to this cotton here. This here has all been ginned. This is all cotton from Virginia, Valentine's, Virginia.
Using cotton, raw cotton, as material is really important because as materially oriented as I am, it's all because there is a context for those materials. For the exhibition, there will be three large sculptural works. I've been calling them slabs because of their relationship to architecture. They're made from wildly different materials.
I actually forgot why I put this in here. Oh yeah, so in the idea of reclaiming culture, to take something that has sort of a metaphoric symbolism of oppression, like he said, it's just a plant being a plant. And it's the metaphor of the material itself. So he takes all these items that are made out of cotton. You see the mortarboard here and the graduation robe. These were his graduation robe and mortarboard from Yale. And he took things that were all made of cotton, but that had other meanings, had other metaphoric associations for him, and put them in these things. And then even the sound of a cotton gin became a piece of sound art. So this notion that you could take, that you could reclaim something that was a material of oppression and turn it into something else and flip it and almost use it in like an accusatory way is pretty remarkable. The other example I had was a YouTube with Ta-Nehisi Coates.
Yeah, I use this in class.
Do you? Yeah. So the use of the N-word in rap music, and basically words that don't belong to everybody,
right,
is a whole conversation, right? So, and this to me seems like an appropriate time to have a conversation like this as well.
Perfect.
So the project proposal itself would be to have students, after having these discussions, which is the important part, most of your time should be in discussion and working out these issues together. And then the actual project is the kids would make their own Kermit meme with the punchline, "But that's none of my business." And what they have to do is take whatever that dominant culture is, take, satirize or critique hypocrisy in it, and take something that's from that culture and flip it, and have Kermit passive aggressively say, "But that's none of my business." So what does that show you? If you make a funny meme, it shows that you understand. It shows that you understand dominant culture, the artifacts of culture, and how the minority group can satirize or critique the culture by appropriating an aspect of it, which when you put it in sort of academic terms like that sounds very difficult, but it's something that is all over Twitter all day long.
Right.
It's everywhere. So there's lots of examples of that. And that's why you want them to research. And by research, you can tell them explicitly, it's not something that's dry and boring. It's, you're looking for something you have interest in. In this case, you're looking for relevant Kermit memes, which should be kind of fun. So now that you've done this and the kids have had this experience, you want to spend most of the time refining those jokes with them. And again, the project part, making a Kermit meme, takes seconds. That takes seconds. It's the thinking part that you want them to do. Now you can teach them how slaves incorporated, they did the same thing. They incorporated elements of white Christianity into the structure of their own culture. And you could talk about things like call and response and all these things that are purely African and took on the trappings of the dominant culture so that they became sort of invisible. And in that way, they were used to as a code, as a secret language. So by doing it, the minority culture and the oppressed culture was able to not only preserve their own identity, but they were able to communicate through it right in front of their oppressors. So really the lesson is about the social dynamics of it all. And I think by doing a project like this, if you grapple with the power dynamic, then when you teach the content, it makes sense. Because they've then had to make something like that. And then you're basically saying, look how these people did that. And then, there's sort of built-in interest that way. And it just already makes sense because you've like primed the pump, so to speak, right? Are there any questions or comments about any of that? Does that seem like possible? Do you feel like that's something you could do in your class?
Yes, I feel like I have an idea and a pathway to do this, yeah. So again, like that idea that I thought about, and actually I was talking to Caitlin about it, like this idea of even that big, large question around how can the oppressed use their oppressor's culture as a subversive weapon? You could argue that so much of African American centered or bass music and genres, that was the key, you know?
Yeah.
And so it is something that if I were to introduce early on that would help me also, discuss the spirituals to, blues music, to jazz music, to hip hop, like it would be a common theme, which is what I was trying to get to. And again, like I said, I'm blown away that from my piddlings on the computer that you were able to help me brainstorm to something that's much more robust. And that's why I asked my question earlier, is just how do I begin to think that way? So I don't want to dominate the thing. So, but thank you. No, this is definitely doable and actually something I'm plan to execute. So I will be coming back to the well and asking you for help.
Yeah, for sure.
I have a comment, question, Stephen, yeah. kind mm-hmm. of question, but you said it and I just wanted to hear it from you. Mm-hmm. So when you're using PBL, and I know I'm just thinking since I'm a language teacher and I teach very basic language, I take liberties where I can with projects, and usually it's something that's like bigger, and I think you saw, maybe it saw mine briefly about immigration. Mm-hmm. But it sounds like, do you use PBL just as a primer for your content, or
no.
Okay, but for someone like us, for us just starting out, would you suggest that be like the vehicle or the avenue that we take first before it becomes part of maybe like a major unit?
I think in that case I would think about doing a series of projects and think about the scaffolding of skills.
Got it.
So if there was something that you were building to, because when you're doing language, you have to acquire vocabulary, you have to acquire, grammar, and you're trying to speak. There's all these things. So I think what it is, what I would focus on is, and especially because early on, there's no mastery, right? So what you're trying to build is some sort of mastery, not only of the speaking part, it's kind of performative in that way, right?
Mm-hmm.
So
totally.
That's going to take time before they get there. So the kinds of things I would think about would be tiny things to acquire. Maybe they need like technical skills, like making very small movies or making digital images or small posters or something like this. So that you're sort of scaffolding skills that you can use for a bigger project later on.
Okay.
And then that bigger project later on, what I would be thinking about is how can they use the skills that, like, how can you motivate them to gain mastery in those areas without them thinking about what they're doing? You know, if the focus is on something else that's going to require mastery of those skills for them to do this other thing, that's how I would sort of construct it.
Got it.
So we could think, you know, we could brainstorm some.
Yeah, no, that's
that
perfect.
Do that.
Thank you.
That's what I would think about.
Stephen, I had a question kind of based off of what Caitlin was just saying. And I was trying to formulate this over the last couple of days, like figure mm-hmm. out where I was going with this. I noticed like when we try to teach a lot of the skills in world and US history, a lot of them are abstract, subjective kind of skills, not quite at this level, but definitely there. And what we always get from the kids is, you know, what's the next step? What's the next part of the formula? What's the exemplar? How do I move to the next? And what you're teaching is awesome. I mean, this is so, and it's such an important skill of being able to go through a process where there is no exact formula of the next step. It's something the kids have to kind of figure out through experience and mistakes and successes and all that. But they get so fearful of that. And
yes.
They're so like, they depend upon you to be like, what's the next step? What's it? How do you get them beyond that?
You have to destigmatize errors. So formative assessment is a big deal. I give them assessments that are very casual and low stakes. So there has to be some sort of point so that they're accountable, but make it really low stakes. And then let them know that the final project is going to be high stakes. Like so high stakes that they could literally fail. They could get zeros on all of the formative assessments and it wouldn't matter because they won't remember that anyway. They only freak out about what's in front of them. So, but you know, if you can reassure them because they've been trained up to this point to memorize something and spit it out, or that they have to get the right answer, that they're afraid to try something because if they don't do it right, it's like a perfectionism. It's paralyzing. So part of it is kind of building the culture into your class that if you get a zero, it doesn't matter. It's fine. Like, I'm giving you the zero And so I try not to, actually, on the formative things, I can do like 10, 5, 0 points. So that, so it's a very broad brush, and the zero means has less pain that way. And it's just like a check-in. So most of it is just like, this makes more sense to art teachers and music teachers, because actually if you're a coach, it's, this is more like coaching, right? You're just constantly like setting a boundary, and you're trying to keep them moving down the path, but they're the ones that have to do it. And what, because you're in the classroom, they're going to keep asking you, what's the answer? What's the answer? What's the answer? And some kids are going to really struggle with that. They're going to be like, just tell me what to do. Like, they're not going to know what to do. And the problem is you're asking them to generate an idea. So it's just something you have to kind of cultivate in them. But yeah, having low stakes formative assessments and making it really clear that it's not going to damage their grades forever. The thing that I often get is, you know, because I give lots of zeros on those things, and I have a GIF that I put in Google Docs all the time of, I think it's LeBron or somebody like swatting a basketball away from the little kid. And I say, this is me with your lame ass answers. Because they show up with just some of the worst, you will get some of the worst work you've ever seen until they understand, like, because they're used to just turning something in because they're focused on the points. And you have to kind of cultivate this idea of redoing things until they get it right. It's a studio mindset. Dave, you had a thing?
Yeah, just to piggyback that, I remember yesterday Stephen had a point, you know, the topic was, but I can't draw. That's always a go-to default assumption about if you teach art, you can draw. I can't draw to save my life. But the point of that is like incorporate what you're interested in as a teacher, creative-wise. We all have a creative, you know, interest in something. Like James, you were doing Photoshop. We talked about Photoshop last couple of years, right? We've been going over some things, you and I, one-on-one, and do something like that. So it could be whatever you're interested in. Yeah. I think as teachers, we should always be learning, especially now with 2020, going to 2021, like there's so much technology happening, so many different types of apps that are available. We have to be open to learning and not feel like we're stuck in one way, in one, you know, generational concept of what we really believe, but we have to be flexible. And so if you bring in something that you like, that's all that matters. Right, Stephen? I mean, if you're into something, you're going to...
This is your opportunity too. Yeah.
Yeah, so it's like extra exciting because you want to... Something as simple as making a meme to become very profound, or Stephen doing some crazy, you know, animated video on his phone. I mean, the levels are definitely, you know, varying. So, I mean, Stephen's a little savvy in those areas more than I am, for sure. But I just make that point of, like, if you're interested in something that is catching your attention, definitely incorporate that, and that can become a platform for a project. Yeah. Anyway.
Since we're talking about James, let's look at yours. So James wrote, fine arts and history share in using interpretive skills. I love this. These are not entirely quantitative. They are largely subjective and qualitative, but this sometimes allows students to be imprecise or not elaborate. I want students to see, express, and explain multiple layers of meaning. So I highlighted that part. And that's great, because all those words are verbs. They're active, and it's focused on what they're doing. That's great. I want students to take artistic representations, place them in their context, and explain how those artistic movements were attempting to express multiple layers of meaning about individuals, their society, and history of the time period. So this is what I was talking about. This is what I always did, is we're studying a period. And so, well, we could take contemporary music and art of the time and give a fuller picture of what that time was like. But like I said, that's just more information that they also are not familiar with. What I highlighted was the word take. And I said, I would replace the word take with the word make and try to accomplish something similar. I find it to be too general. Like, I would prefer seeing students create something and manufacture something from their own experience rather than just find things that are relevant. That's sort of, that's kind of collegiate, right? This is quite, that requires a lot of background knowledge that they're just not gonna have. So it has to be something where we're tapping into things that they already know and that they can relate to. I talked a lot here about the Harlem Renaissance because that's what you were talking about. But the more as I went on with it, I sort of abandoned that a little bit. Like here I said, I think you want to use art as a gateway into understanding and experiencing multiple perspectives and interpretations. It now becomes less clear to me why you might focus on the Harlem Renaissance artists. That is more because it's more a fundamental feature of art or history, the disciplines themselves. So the reason for focusing in on the Harlem Renaissance, just by saying that, becomes a little less clear to me. If the idea is really about art revealing multiple perspectives as a gateway for the consideration of the subjective in history, I'd use art that does exactly that. Again, focus on the practices that have disciplines in common. Maybe it's about history and historicism. And the reason I thought of this was because I heard on NPR something about the Supreme Court and how one of them was saying that, I don't know, one of the liberal justices was saying something about how one of the conservative justices, who's the one that died? Anyway, how he was a textualist and that we're all textualists now. I forget who said that.
Scalia,
yes. Yeah. Scalia was a textualist. And so we're all, and liberal and conservative justices were saying now we're all textualists. And there's this idea that there is history and then there is historicism. And a lot of the conflicts and things that we're talking about, like with structural racism, is about historicism. And do we, or with the Supreme Court, do we look at a law or the Constitution as literally how the framers wrote it in the context of their time? Or do we adapt that to the you know, or do, you know what I'm saying, right? So in other words, these principles, these legal principles of precedent and conventions and things like that. So if there, in other words, it's philosophy. If there is no single universal truth, then it's the job of the historian to understand the complexities of the past to give a fuller picture of how we arrived at our present state. So your big question was, I came up with, is very, very broad, and because I saw it as like an introduction to your class. Is history objective? That's your guiding light. So then the evidence would be that students can analyze art and history and realize there might be different truths. Students realize that the type and manner of storytelling influences the perception of history. Students can speak about the differences between history and historicism, that is, history shaped by people versus societal structures. So the project, immediately I thought of Rashomon. I don't know if you're familiar with it, but Akira Kurosawa made one of the greatest movies ever in the history of film, that about a samurai, someone dies, somebody maybe gets raped, it's not clear. And it's basically a story from four perspectives. And you go through each of the perspectives and you get a completely different story depending on whose perspective you get this story from. This idea has been appropriated to the extreme. And I found this website called TV Tropes, and it lists all kinds of things that use this Rashomon, what they call the Rashomon effect. Anime and manga, comic books, comic strips, fan fiction, films, animation, films, live action, jokes, literature, live action TV, radio drama, tabletop games, theater, video games, visual novels, web, and on. You get the idea. If you open any one of these, there's infinite examples that just go on and on and on and on and on of this idea of basically the unreliable narrator, right? So you could use one or several of these to introduce this concept, which is basically history, right? How is our story told to us? I detail, like, there's a SpongeBob episode that's very fast. Boondocks, which may or may not be appropriate for school, I don't know, but it is really funny. And it's the same thing as Rashomon. Questions would be, how can media, so we have these media that tell these stories, right, over time. How can media influence perception of a story? I found a piece of art. There's a piece called My Neck is Thinner Than a Hair, Poland Engines by Atlas Group, which isn't a real group, and Walid Rad. Walid is, I think he's Lebanese. And he scanned images from the bombings in Beirut in like the 90s up to about 2000. And it is a series of photographs with his annotations. There's about 100 of them. And they're all weirdly, these are the images. And on the Tate Modern website, you can see each one. It's really wonderful. Each one is a car engine because they were all car bombs. And during the period that he took all these pictures in Beirut, this document of war, these are real pictures. There were something like 252 car bombings in the time period when he did this. When you abstract it like this, it's almost ridiculous. I'm tipping my hat here. On the Tate website, there is a really wonderful write-up. So you could look at this, and I came up with some questions. What is the artist's intention presenting this investigative work? It is sort of like journalism, but it's also like on YouTube, like supercuts, you know, where they take like somebody saying a single word or all the examples of somebody like Owen Wilson going, oh, or whatever, you know, and putting it into one thing. When you group things together, they have their own power. So these would be things to have a discussion with. Can you separate the art from the truth? Is there a difference between the reality and the presentation of the artist's imagination? How does this work compare from what we see in mainstream news media? So it'd take a little bit of research. And what do you think this artist's point of view is and why? Whatever evidence leads you to think this. The project you could make would be to tie it into something contemporary. Students research YouTube or Twitter videos, just with hashtags, of news broadcasts about the recent unrest in downtown or WeHo, and compare it to videos taken by people on the street. So people that posted things like under the BLM hashtag or whatever. It's very easy to find. Use screen record on computer or your phone to capture images of both versions without sound. Edit them into side-by-side movies and iMovies. So there's a small technical thing that they would have to learn. Have the student choose a song of their own, whatever, that represents how the event was portrayed on either side. Play 15, on what I meant to say was on both sides. One for the mainstream side and one for the person on the street side. play 15 to 20 seconds of each song with both videos playing at the same time, and note how your perception of either event changes. So the kids aren't taking sides, but they have to evaluate what each of the images, what story each of the images is saying, and then also grapple with what kind of song would represent those images for them. This could go lots of ways. You know, it depends on what media images they've found. Like, I know from my experiences of the protests that many of them were incredibly peaceful and almost like lovey-dovey. I mean, there's like hearts and flowers. And I've seen Twitter videos of pretty outrageous police behavior, people getting hit by cars, like really crazy things. And then I've also seen absolute mayhem and chaos, especially from the early days. And then in the media, like when I was sitting in my house and I hear things that, like bombs going off, and then I watch the news and somebody who's two blocks from me on Main Street is reporting that everything's quiet, is a surreal experience. So I know that these contradictory things are out there. The total duration of this movie would be 30 to 40 seconds. I made a movie to demonstrate what, let me see if I can find it. Here we go. So I made a movie to demonstrate how media can really warp the story just by how it's presented. So what I did was I put together two versions of the TV show Different Strokes theme song.
Hey, Steven?
Yep.
Now the world don't
move. Say it again.
My screen's frozen. Is it just me or?
Same. No, mine's just frozen. It's like,
I can't
yeah.
see the screen,
yeah.
Steven.
Yeah, it's frozen.
Weird.
Try to unshare and unshare.
Unshare and try it again. Here we go. Let's try this. I guess I have to select it. How's that?
Yes.
Now the world don't move to the beat of just one drum. What might be right for you may not be right for some. Find a way to shine. It don't matter that you got not a lot. So what?
it's literally the same video, right? But by doing something as simple as changing the music, you get wildly different expressions of the same thing, right? So the same thing can happen. This is storytelling, and that has a profound impact on history. The way the story is told, the media with which that story is told, who's telling the story. I think these are all the things that you want to, that you want your history students to consider, that just because it's in a book, it's not, you have to consider, in other words, you have to consider the source, you have to contextualize things, right? So I think there's ways to do that, and there's ways that they can use contemporary media with something that is fresh in their experience to draw that comparison. And then you take that experience and apply it to something that's historical. Does that seem like something that's useful?
Yeah, no, that's really cool. I guess I know this is gonna sound like the banal way of asking the question. What's tough, I think, for so many of us, because this is brilliant. I mean, obviously, this is just awesome. And what I love about this, too, is that it forces the kids into multiple layers of interpretation, and they're not into sort of like, I just need to know the facts kind of a thing. So I hate to ask the next question. I'm sure you hate it, too. When you got to move so fast in your class and get so much content done and all that kind of stuff, how does something like this get fit in a way that can help the kids to see that when, you know, especially for AP teachers, we're on such a quick racetrack that we got to get to?
I think the projects don't have to be onerous. Like this, it doesn't even have to take a whole period, really. It's really about the discussion. Because now in your case, the thing that I just came up with, maybe that's an overnighter, you know, research, because they would have to look for some videos. But if you use something like Flipgrid and you just have them find the videos and then throw them all on a Flipgrid where everybody can see them at the same time, and then you just pick them out, you don't even have to make the video, right? So this is where I'm talking about like making the project bigger or smaller. You could extend a project ad infinitum. What you don't want to do is beat a dead horse. You can just keep adding to it or deepening the project, or you can scale it back. Like instead of having everybody make a video, have everybody research videos, make a fast screen cap of it, and then throw it into a Flipgrid, and everybody could see them at the same time. And then you could all curate them together and pick out the ones like, okay, this was a mainstream news version of something happened in downtown. And this is somebody that's just on Twitter, and there's a disparity between these two reports. So it's really less about the product and more, it's always about the process. Like you don't have to end up with something at the end of it, right? If you want to make it a bigger thing, then you can plan for that. But something like this could be done more as a discussion, which is a discussion that you already want to have, right? Because you're trying to, you want them to be empathetic and engaged. And this is a way to tap into that engagement. It's a way to make it relevant. And then you can say, okay, now that you've engaged them, you can then look at this other material and say, well, what was it like for them? That's how I try to do it. So it doesn't have to be an either or proposition. It doesn't have to get into the way of covering, because you're right. Like in AP, you have to cover content because we got to take this test. I think that's probably the biggest stumbling block to this is thinking if I could, the best way I can think of it is to like, you just put your content aside for 1 second and you sort of analyze your content for what are the essential parts of the content. Now, by the way, that different strokes thing, that also opens up lots of issues.
Like,
the no,
I can't stop it,
like
about
watching it,
it
now.
What you talking about, Willis?
Exactly. You know, like the whole white savior thing, and it's a very, very weird, and it's weird for kids to see it now. Kids that didn't grow up with this show, because they're weirded out by the original. they're weirded out by the original one. So
that's all I see now is like, I mean, I swear as a kid, I did not miss that show. My brother and I almost had the exact same age difference between Arnold and Willis. And like, those guys were like our heroes. Like, and not that we live in a bad situation. And now, I text Caitlin maybe 90 seconds ago, like, I saw that clip and all I see is the white savior complex.
Yeah.
That's all I see. Especially, and honestly, I didn't see it until you played the second music. And I was like, holy crap. That's super powerful, man. I might need to use that clip for cultural consciousness training, man.
The second one is it's a funny or die, but I just put the two together.
Wow.
I thought it was funny.
Yeah. No, it's enlightening as well. Very enlightening.
But it is remarkable how, because we are much more likely to respond to something visual, but we don't realize how much the sound has an effect on how we perceive things.
Very subconscious.
Yeah. But the effect that it has is incredibly powerful.
And then if I can say, like James, like if the concept is a really crucial one that you want to go have, and they can use that tool throughout the entire year, might be worth it to do it for one class period, half a class period. It might have its payoff where you don't have to ramp up to it each time you get to it. They'll just know the framework and apply it.
Yeah. Well, I know just to jump in really quick, because I know some of the AP World teachers this year were playing around. John Vella came up with this idea of like creating TikTok videos. And a couple of them did that, where they had the students create TikTok videos, and they were all based off of like skills and memes and themes and that kind of stuff. And some of them create it. And you're right, Terry. It's like they get that thing down, like contextualization, and now it helps for everything else, but they've created a project in the meantime.
And they've made it an emotional connection to your material. And then it'll stay, it just stays there forever. So you don't, it's in a weird way, it's like a shortcut.
Mm-hmm.
It's a shortcut, because if you get them to grapple with it, then if they're really engaged in it and they're doing it properly, they have to do it like so many times over and over and over and over. And they have to think about it. And they're thinking about the really like meaty part of it. And that's what's going to stick. And now they also have this thing that becomes like a mnemonic device to help them remember the content. Any other questions? I don't want to go long today because we went long yesterday, so we could probably wrap up.
This is my 15th class.
You're going to be at Starbucks
Thank you. Thank you. Your brain is one to marvel at, brother. And I am blown away. I don't know. I don't want to speak for everybody, but this was PBL, but it was really also like just thinking about my own pedagogical skills. This was amazing, man. Thank you so much.
Hey, thank you. Thanks for coming. This is honestly, this is art. I was calling it PBL because you can make a project like science stuff. That's a project. Yeah. You know, and science has its own discipline. Those are projects. Like Andre's astronomy class is incredible, and it's constant projects. What I try to do is add the art element. It's arts education.
Yeah, awesome.
Well, if anybody ever wants,
yeah, thank you.
I'm happy to, you know, be a sounding board or help you design something.
I did mine really late, like around noon.
That's okay. Is it in the thing? Because I'll look at it.
Yeah, I'm not. I think it is. It should be.
Yeah.
So yeah, I also did that too. I did mine late, and I haven't looked at it since. Formed.
So. I spent all day on mine.
Ooh. I still haven't taken it. Too.
Yeah, I'll look at them.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Awesome. Thanks, Steven. Yeah. Thanks, Steven. Take care.
Thanks
so much.
Good being here.
He sent me the video.
Yeah, thanks, Dave. I'm sorry. Thank you as well, man.
Thank you both.
David, thank you.
I'm just hanging out.